Hey, everybody. Before we start this final session of the day, I would like to acknowledge that we're meeting, acknowledge the traditional owners, the people of the Kulin Nations, and pay my respect to their elders past and present and their leaders of the future, and also acknowledge that sovereignty was never ceded. I'm Lucy Adams. I'm the Manager of Strategic Advocacy and Policy in the Civil Justice Team at Victoria Legal Aid. And I've also got the great privilege of being the Deputy Chair of the Board of the Council on Homeless Persons. And I thought I might just use this tiny window to recognise the huge amount of work that the team at CHP have put into putting this conference on for us. I think you'll all agree with me that the content they have brought to us in terms of being thought-provoking, highly relevant and progressive will make us all better and stronger as a sector. So thank you all. We are very keen to keep the bar pretty high in terms of the intellectual rigour of the content. So it is time for the debate that we have always wanted to have. Does size matter? So the official title for the debate is Tiny Homes, How Small is Too Small? And even through informal conversations over the course of the last couple of days, it's clear that this is an issue that really probably divides us, and there are lots of different views. Tiny homes are fast becoming part of the landscape for responding to homelessness in Victoria, and there are people who think they are an innovative way of cleverly using design and space to respond to homelessness. And there are others who think that we shouldn't need to resort to the miniature versions of the real deal to effectively respond to homelessness. We are going to hear both sides, and no doubt we are going to hear much, much more from this illustrious lineup of debaters before us. Let me introduce them to you. So we have Pete Zwiers, National Program Manager, Kids Undercover. This is the affirmative team. It's the pro-tiny homes team. Rob Pradolin, founding board member of advocacy group Housing All Australians. Bevan Warner, CEO of Launch Housing. And then on the negative side, saying that there is in fact room for small to be too small, we have Sam Sowerwine, principal lawyer of Justice Connect Homeless Law. Jeanette Large, CEO, Women's Property Initiative. And Damien Patterson, policy and advocacy officer, Council to Homeless Persons. Now, it will not come as a surprise to you that debating is a game of rules, and the rules that we have before us today are that each speaker will have 7 minutes. That is the time they have to make their full argument and include all their rebuttals and gags. There won't be a second opportunity. I will ring the bell at 6 minutes and then more unrelentingly at 7 minutes. You, as the audience, will be the judges. So prepare to exercise your judgment. At the end, it'll be done through the online poll and also through a sign of applause. I also, strangely, get to award the best debater, and that they can come from either the winning or losing teams, like a Norm Smith medal for former prefects. So without further delay, I'd like to introduce Pete Zwiers to get you started for the affirmative.
Thank you so much, Lucy. Hello, everyone. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I am lying, of course. Can I start by saying that I haven't actually done any debating since year seven. God knows when that was. And I might be a little bit rusty, so please stick with me. I think that, debating, really it's just public speaking, isn't it? So it's not that hard, it's just being judged by your peers on everything you say in front of 300 people. So it's totally the same thing, but let's get on with it. We believe that tiny homes are a fit for purpose, practical and desirable option for the housing market, and that they can help to solve homelessness. In fact, they already are in some cases. Our team today is going to prove just that. I've gone first, I've drawn the short straw. I don't know if it's good or bad, but I'm up first. Following me is going to be Rob. He's going to bring a more private sector argument to this, which is going to be very interesting. And lastly is Bevan. We all know Bevan, CEO of Launch Housing, I've really gotten to know Bevan the last couple of weeks while we've been preparing for this, and he's so generous with his time. He's so lovely. There is a butt coming. But not today, not today. Bevan's coming out third, and he told me that he is going to rain down the fury on the opposition arguments once they are made. He didn't actually say that. Guys, don't worry. He said that. But firstly, let's be clear on what we're talking about, because there's a lot of ideas about, you know, what tiny homes are. Firstly, what is a home? I think we've all covered this pretty well over the last 2 days. What is a home, actually? It's more than a house, isn't it? It's more than four walls and a roof. A home, we need to be private, we need security, we need safety, it's a place of nurture, a place of retreat. And it's essentially, I think, it's like a kind of a solid base from which, you know, we can have the chance to live a good life. And we all of us in this room know how hard that can be without having one. The good news is that a tiny home is all of those things, but just in a more pint-sized practical package. Tiny homes can be small, they can be relocatable, they can be practical, affordable, and even kind of cool. Our frenemies over here don't agree with us. That's fine. They have a love of the larger homes, and I don't even blame them. I think we're all attuned to that, to be honest. I think it's a cultural thing in Australia. We actually live in the second largest homes in the world in Australia. It's what we've been attuned to. But largesse does not equal success, and I think we can agree on that when we think about the housing market as it is. Perhaps we've all forgotten a little bit that tiny is actually better, and I'm not even talking about homes now. Tiny is better in everything. Tiny is... I wasn't... That's not what I was... tiny is... but, yeah. Tiny is healthy, it's ethical, it's sustainable, it's fit for purpose, and it's even cute. That's how bad I want to win this thing, all right? I have no problem. What else we got that's tiny that's awesome? Mom, I'm hungry. Eat some fruit. No. Tiny teddies. Like, they got me through my childhood. Tiny drinks. Got me through adulthood. I'm hungover just looking at that. Elton John, Tiny Dancer, best song. One of the best songs ever. If you take the word tiny out of that song, you have a vastly different song. Do it yourself in your head, you'll get there. I'll leave that up to you. Bonsais. How beautiful and elegant are bonsais? I've killed about 40 of them myself. Puppies. These guys don't even like puppies. It's so sad. And of course, Greta. Greta is just proof that the world's changing and tiny is powerful. Tiny started a global movement and tiny homes are doing the same thing. I think Greta's actually going to be working on the tiny home movement, someone was saying in the press, once she finishes with climate change. Getting back to the actual, what we're supposed to be talking about, we believe that tiny homes can meet the varied needs of homelessness. There are many varied groups that need assistance and they need varied solutions. One size fits all, so to speak, isn't going to work. So I want to show you quickly now three projects that are on the ground that are happening using tiny homes, helping to make a difference. This is the first one. This is the Tiny Homes Foundation in Gosford. So in 2018, they set up four tiny homes on the one block with wraparound supports, and they saw improvements immediately in young persons' employment, education and mental health. Two young people of the four have already graduated, so to speak, to independent living, and another two are in. So they've helped six people in the last 12 months, so I think that's fantastic. Next up, Launch Housing. I know someone at Launch Housing. Launch Housing, this is great. So 57 tiny homes on nine blocks of Vic Roads land, Vic Track land, over in Footscray. To help people who have experienced chronic homelessness, another group that really needs help. What I love about this is it addresses the shortage of single-person dwellings that we have in the market. Again, supports are in place. I think you've got 14 completed so far. Is that right? And what I really like about this is designed to help, you know, the fastest-growing group of homeless that we have, women over 55. This is ideal. Lastly, we've got Village 21. This is something Kids Undercover has cooked up with Anglicare Victoria. And it's being funded as a pilot by DHHS on a site in Preston. Six young people, essentially this is home stretch. Six young people who are exiting care at age 18 can live here for up to 3 years, and they've got employment, education, training, but also living skills, developing living skills to be able to, such as financial budgeting, stuff like that, to be able to move to independence. What I love about these projects is they've got a few things in common. The wraparound tailored supports, which is so important. They've also they also build community. When you put these tiny homes into a community like this, they have the young people or whoever have more incidental contact with their neighbours in a supportive environment. There's also better connection with nature, which has been proven. I remember actually Auntie Shirley was saying that yesterday. Sometimes she just needs to walk outside and connect with nature. And that's also what we're trying to do here, which is so good for everyone's mental health. Best bit about these as well is that they work and they're scalable. We can go. We just need the land and we can go and we can help as many young people as we can and provide as many housing options for everyone as we can. Thank you for listening. Have a good afternoon.
I have to warn, I do not have any amazing photographs of very cute, tiny things. But I do want to thank our learned friends here in the affirmative team for their excellent spin doctoring that's clearly been perfected by many, many a year of media cameos. Today, our team will expose tiny homes for what they really are. At best, a better than nothing form of transitional accommodation that make government and philanthropists feel really good about themselves, provide a Herald Sun good news story, we love those, but they don't actually address the real issue, which is really government chronically underinvesting in social and affordable housing. Our very feisty underdog team today, pitted against these eminent media superstars, will persuade you all that the best kind of tiny home is the tiniest of them all, a non-existent one. Jeanette, our incredible CEO from Women's Property Initiative, will debunk all the spin you've just heard about the wonderful cost effectiveness and efficiency of tiny homes, as well as the question of how livable that tiny space really is. And then Damien, representing the hipster policy geeks of the world, will give you a very personal takedown of why tiny homes, as an eligible hot young thing, perhaps not the best, as well as a searing analysis and takedown of why tiny homes are just a real distraction from the key issue, which is the need for investment in social and affordable housing. But I want to start in good debating fashion, and I'm told this because I've never done debating. I'm told that we have to do some definitions at the start. I'm the first speaker. So I want to start with clarifying what tiny homes are not. Because I know what many of you out there are probably imagining, and actually, thanks for those slides, because I think that they are some of those things, including the little tiny furry animal. So, you know, it's that gorgeous little wooden cabin. It's built out of sustainable, organic, vegan, plantation timber. It's architecturally designed within an inch of its life. It's nestled amongst native trees, lots of nature to look at. It's beautiful. Set across a spectacular cliff top, maybe with some small furry animals frolicking in the grass next to it. If you're lucky, there might even be some snow on the ground. And there's always a tiny little chimney with adorable plumes of smoke rising up. And if you're lucky, there might even be a tiny little jacuzzi on the front veranda for you to pop into after a long day. When you walk inside, it's like a Swiss chalet winter wonderland full of finished timber floors and flooring, you know, that mood lighting, and kitchen counters, even with built-in dog beds. I'm serious. Google it. But that's not the reality of tiny homes that we're talking about today. No, let me tell you about the reality of tiny homes. Tiny homes are really just a glorified shipping container. If you're lucky, in fact, they could be a fancy caravan. In fact, if you really want to get a full picture of what a tiny home is, I hear that down the road at Port Phillip Prison, they've just installed some new ones for the influx of residents. So if you want to go check one out, I recommend that. So, our wonderful affirmative team here argue that tiny homes provide a solution to the homelessness crisis because they're quite efficient and cheaper and quicker to build than social or affordable housing and provide, you know, a tailored approach. That may well be the case on face value, but it doesn't deal with the real issue, which is, I think we can all agree, and this conference has attested to that, that basically people experiencing homelessness need access to secure, appropriate, long-term accommodation where they can build security and a sense of community. Tiny homes don't provide security of tenure or long-term solution. With tiny homes situated on government-owned land, people will simply be forced to move when the government decides they want to sell the land. And we all know how principled government is about not selling off public land for private use. I mean, look, we really didn't need those police stations or schools anyway. So this just creates more uncertainty for people instead of creating a sense of community and belonging. Tiny homes become yet another form of transitional housing with nowhere to go at the other end. In fact, if people do settle in the community, they'll then be forced to uproot somewhere else, we don't know where, somewhere the government is willing to provide some land, further destabilising people who have experienced significant trauma in their lives. Let's face it, tiny homes are just a glorified version of caravan parks, designed to make middle-class people feel better about housing people experiencing homelessness in substandard and insecure accommodation. And we've all seen how well caravan parks are working at the moment, right? I mean, basically they're all being sold off because the value of the land far exceeds any profit that can be made off them. As my two teammates will extrapolate in far funnier and better detail, tiny homes may be better than living on streets or in the crisis accommodation, but they don't provide adequate living space. People need dignity and independence, and in a long-term sense, we need access to proper living spaces to have social lives. This is especially the case for people who don't have a lot of disposable income and aren't sitting in cafes eating avocado on toast every day. We need to create large enough living spaces for people to live dignified, independent lives, and particularly for people who've experienced tough lives, we need to make them feel like they are worthy of proper, adequate housing. And finally, let's face it, tiny homes, they're just a cute little distraction from a far uglier reality. The government needs to do its job and to deal with the shortage of affordable and social housing that it has created. It's not news to anyone in this room that Victoria now has 83,000 people on the housing register, and yet we have an increased net spending on public housing since 2015, and in fact there are less public housing properties than there were 10 years ago. In this context, tiny homes are just a drop in the ocean of current demand. And though they may be well-intentioned, tiny homes are just another form of housing privatisation that lets government off the hook. And it's really time that government steps up. So rather than investing our energies and money into these very cute tiny homes that won't even begin to touch the sides in relation to need, though admittedly they will make a very nice puff piece in the Herald Sun, what we need to do is use the resources we have to ensure the government creates permanent and adequate housing solutions to people. Just because government believes investment in social housing should be tiny doesn't mean that we need to take that literally and follow suit.
Thank you, Sam. And can I start off by saying, making the statement that small is good. Small homes, or tiny homes as some may call it, may not be the entire solution for homelessness, but they sure can go a long way to help. And I think we've tried to get a side here that tried to put up an argument, but somehow I don't think it gelled with us anyhow. And you've heard the opening arguments from both sides, and I would like to thank Peter for introducing what I believe is a very compelling argument, or the basis of. And as you've also seen, that small can also be beautiful and endearing. I can't understand how our opponents actually believe that greed is good, that bigger homes are the solution to homelessness. I think they've been reading too many books by Gordon Gekko saying that size does matter. Small homes make sense from a sustainability perspective. They make sense when looking at the creation of a community and facilitating a greater connection between people, because ultimately homes are all about connections. And importantly, they make sense from an economic perspective. Let me declare that I'm the developer that, that Melanie Redmond mentioned this morning in her opening session, and I am from the private sector. I'm not in your world, but I'm on your side. I believe that housing's all Australians, rich or poor, is a fundamental economic piece of infrastructure and a platform to create a successful country. The business case is compelling. So I come to this problem with a commercial lens, and this guides my views to the housing solution. Yesterday, the prominent Jenny Smith asked an extremely pertinent question to the panel during the breakout session on mental health and homelessness. When the discussion moved to government spending on money on mental health, she asked the panel, what chance does it really have to get up due to the competing demands? That is a very real-world question. Resources are not unlimited. And as Australia's first professor of homelessness, Guy Johnson said yesterday, we don't solve homelessness without building more housing. But with scarce resources, the bigger the house gets, the less we can afford to build. And to paraphrase what Stephen Hart said yesterday in his opening address, you eventually have to fix the pipe, and that means building more houses and economics. That must be considered. But being from the private sector, I believe in listening to the market. Listening to the market and saying, rather than in my own personal views, and I'm not saying that the market is always perfect, but it's the best indicator of demand that we have. And the market is telling us that sustainability is important. Look at the recent march by our young people against climate change. The built environment is one of our greatest polluters. Therefore, the bigger the house, the more greenhouse gases are generated, the more environmental damage is done. And this applies to running the home as well. Yes, we can hear our opposition saying our houses are 10-star energy rated, and yes, they are still 10 times bigger than small homes and therefore still consume 10 times more energy. Imagine for a moment if everyone in Australia lived in a small home. How much less damage would we have done to the planet, and how much lower would our carbon footprint be, and ongoing operational costs and production of CO2 if we were all just living in a small community? And Stephen also said that international engagement and learning what others are doing is crucial. We have heard from Pete what we are doing in Victoria and Australia, so let me share with you a little bit about what they're doing internationally. In 2005 in Texas, planning started on a tiny house village on 10 hectares, which was to house 200 chronically homeless men and women. And they were approaching this as a community first village, because it's all about connection, not about the size of the home. In 2013, ground was broken and the community village started. And at this small home village, they built community facilities that supplemented what the small homes didn't have. Things like laundry, restrooms, outdoor kitchens, community cinemas, catering, and it goes on. And it's all about creating connection. And in 2018, the adjoining site was purchased and the village expanded to 20 hectares to cater for 500 small homes. Housing the chronically homeless. The market was saying that they liked what they saw. And why does it seem to work? Let me read out a couple of lines from their homepage. As a result of the multitude of connections we've made with our homeless neighbours, we've learnt that a single and greatest cause of homelessness is a profound and catastrophic loss of family. They created their own family through the community, and this was done using tiny homes to create a village. And as we heard yesterday, again, through breaking the nexus between mental health and homelessness, it's all about community and people caring. It has nothing to do with the size of the home. So if our opponents today had only one choice in life to make, one choice, they would say they prefer to be part of a soulless community with larger houses than live in a small or tiny community like in Austin, Texas, where people interact with each other and where people support each other, where they prioritise care for others as one of their foundational values. So I know which one I'd choose out of those two options. But I have to acknowledge that the creation of small homes have unintended consequences. Think of our Minister for Housing. Think of the new announcements that he'll be able to make. Think of rather than announcing 1,000 homes, he's able to say the government is listening to the people and we're building 10,000 homes. And imagine the Treasurer. He'll also be smiling because it's not costing him any more money. So we need to think of these unintended consequences when we're thinking about creating smaller homes and that barrage of announcement that we'll all be subjected to and the re-announcements again that this will generate. So there are some downsides. But in concluding, I would like to say that I understand our opponents have a bias towards larger houses. This is an unconscious bias that's been formed during a period which has been dominated by a man's view of the world, when size did matter. But today we have a more balanced view of the world, where size does not matter anymore. And to paraphrase Cathy Humphreys from Sacred Heart Mission, it has to be fit for purpose. Small is good.
So it seems we have a number of people here today on this debating team who have never debated in their life before, including me. So Rob, the developer, talks about soul, which was interesting, and community. Anyway, what is the difference actually between small and tiny? And I'm just wondering, how small is the house that you actually live in, Rob? But anyway, so how small is too small? Is having to decide you have a table and chairs or a couch too small? Is having people to sit on your bed as the only option if you have one or more two visitors too small? Is having the only storage space available up a ladder that, depending on your ability and age, may or may not be possible to reach and use too small? Is only being able to have a single bed, making it challenging to start a new relationship or continue one, too small? Is having a place where you can't have a wheelchair or a walker too small? So what are the assumptions if you say, no, that's not too small, to what I've just asked? Assumptions are, one, you don't have friends. If you do, you certainly cannot entertain them in your home, or not more than one at a time, or maybe your friends don't like each other, so it's not a problem. You really don't care if people are invading the private space of your bed? Why should you want private space? The weather will always be fine, not too hot, not too cold, so you can entertain by spreading out into the decking, if you have any decking. You are definitely fit and agile to be able to go up and down that ladder to get your stuff. Or you don't have stuff. Why should you have stuff? You're a poor person. Interesting that I just hear that one of the tiny homes is actually focused on women 55 years of age and over. Just like to see them going up and down that ladder a lot to get their stuff. And ageing in place doesn't really matter, does it? Because it's temporary housing anyway. It's going to be moved, demountable, and moved on. So what's the issue about ageing in place? The women we house actually live in their houses. They don't go out, eat out every night. They don't go out for breakfast. They don't go out clubbing. If they want to socialise, it's often in their home. And sometimes they want to have more than one or two people over. And they do have family, and they have stuff. Who are the people who have decided that the space provided in tiny homes is adequate and livable? Could it possibly be that they're your middle-class individuals who actually have one of these tiny homes on their bush block they go to on weekends? It's environmentally sound and sustainable, and it's wonderful for a couple of nights at a time. Could it be your young professionals who live in small apartments, who socialise outside of their home? They eat out, they work late, they go clubbing, they come home and flop into a bed. Yes, usually a double bed. That's all they really need. Could it be that these middle-class people and young professionals actually hire storage to keep all their stuff that they cannot keep in their main residence? Possibly a storage space that's larger than a tiny home. Oh yes, low-income Centrelink recipients may not be able to afford to hire storage. So why should homeless people need anything more than what a middle-class person or young professional can cope with and enjoy as their form of living? If one of those is actually only staying on a bush block for a couple of nights, are we really looking at this from a privileged position of middle class? Are those providing the housing looking at the issue from the point of view of what is easy for them as the providers of the housing? The smaller they are, the easier to be dismantled, movable, and relocated. The whole short term, moving to another location is such an issue in itself. When I worked in a women's homelessness service, many of the women would not connect with their community, and that included with their child's school. They wouldn't look for part-time work. They wouldn't look for to return to study, even though they're in their transitional housing, you know, as we all know, for 2+ years or even longer. But they weren't exactly sure how long they'd be living in that community because it wasn't permanent housing. How important is social connectedness and inclusion to emotional and mental health? Very important. And it's social connectedness that you want, not what you've been forced to live in by being put in a tiny house very close to others. For some of the tiny homes, yes, as we've heard, there's communal space provided. But unless you've actually chosen to live in a co-housing community, which was being explained before, the shared laundries and living space, great for those who want to live there. But the community space could actually be useless if you don't want to mix with those people. But you've been forced to live there just to get a roof over your head. I once attended a forum where a woman said, "I'm glad I've learned about co-housing because now I know exactly where I don't want to live." You want to socialise with friends and family who you choose to invite to your home, and you want the room to be able to do this. You don't want to be tripping over your stuff, and you don't want your friends and family to be tripping over it either, and that's clogging up your living space. So how small is too small? You can't have a table and chairs and a couch. You can't have more than 2 people visiting and comfortably in your home. You don't have adequate and suitable storage. You can't comfortably have your partner stay overnight. Aging in place is not an option. And let's hope that possibly you like spooning, because that's all you'll be able to do in your single bed. And then the cost. Yes, you'll hear the cost. $60,000 to build, how wonderful. But what about the $90,000 of additional costs for infrastructure such as vehicle access and services, power, water, sewage connections, site preparation and foundations, planning? They are not exempt from planning. They must go through planning processes, transport to site, traffic management, particular issue in inner urban areas along major roads and tram lines. Supposedly a quick turnaround time, all of the above does not only cost, but it takes time. There is no way around the requirement of not making the sites ready for housing, tiny and mobile or not. And the delays in planning, which as we know, can get embroiled in local controversy from the NIMBYs, and when the media pick up the story, all result in not such a quick turnaround time. And it seems you can either pay higher unit costs to have a quicker build turnaround time, or you have long lead times due to capacity issues of the builder. No matter what the cost, we all know that the most expensive part of our housing is the land. Wouldn't it be better to advocate to government to provide surplus land to community housing organisations to build permanent long-term housing? We need investment in safe, secure, long-term and where needed housing, and where needed support services that will provide the support for mental health, family violence, general living skills, skills that ensure the tenancy is sustained and the person benefits from having a stable housing that will result in them maybe finding work, maybe going back to study, but having being able to live with dignity, not a tiny home with where a yuppie might think it's wonderful to have on their bush block to go to for a weekend. Thank you.
Welcome everybody, and thanks to my colleagues Pete and Rob for presenting such a convincing case that tiny homes are not only desirable but a preferred housing solution. Pete and Rob were so good, so convincing, that I'm actually going to hand some of my time back. I don't need a large block of time, I just need a tiny bit, and I just need the essential minimum necessary for the task. So 3 minutes should be enough. So Damien, you can load up, mate. You can load up with my extra 4 minutes. You can make a big supersized meal of it. You can go to town if you like. Max out, smash up our arguments like an avocado plus toast, 2 slices of toast with an egg, maybe a hash brown on this side, the just in case mushrooms, and maybe a belching piece of halloumi. Guzzle away at the microphone, drink in the air, soak up the crowd, and because I'm going to do you in 3. That's all I need. Now, Pete made the case. Pete made the case that judging a home by size alone is both foolish and foolhardy, and he's right. We all know a home is a feeling. It's not a structure. A home invokes a feeling of safety, security and connectedness. And Jeanette, do your research. It's better than temporary housing, transitional housing. It's a permanent offer. So you don't wake up thinking, I love my skirting boards after a holiday. You don't get on a plane or on the bus and say, gee whiz, I can't wait to get to back to my brick paving. You don't come home at night, count your superannuation, rove around your many bedrooms or the many rooms in your house and sit on seven different chairs. You know, you sit on your chair, you know, the one that you always sit on, the one that fits you and your circumstances, you know. And I say it again, a home invokes a feeling of safety, security and connectedness. A home is a pleasurable state of mind. I mean, come on, who cares if your status in life requires two toilet brushes, you know, to accompany your three bedrooms and the outdoor kitchen, to go with the indoor kitchen alongside the pizza oven and the barbecue kettle, or not? I mean, you can only use one convenience at a time, am I right? I was going with the poo joke, but I stopped there. Not everyone wants, needs or aspires to trophies or trophy houses. They want a pleasurable state of mind. And really, this lazy, trite line that it's all about size needs to be called out for what it is. It's a confected bluster propped up by a poultice of privilege and bias. I mean, come on. You can't even treat a zucchini that way. I mean, you wouldn't say, gee, big zucchini equals good zucchini, because we know that bigger doesn't necessarily equal tastier. I mean, the grape vintage doesn't taste better when water is added to plump the grape. The best wine is made from sun-ripened grapes that have concentrated their nectar. So, second key point. Unfortunately, the laws of nature and of fruit and vegetables seem lost on this other side of envious malcontents, drearily obsessed by how big is yours. Well, I mean, come on, be serious. The French figured this out long ago in their cuisine and in their style. The French have given us elegance, an elegant sufficiency on the plate, an elegance in style that emphasises attitude and favours minimalist basics over big, boisterous bling. An elegant sufficiency on the plate, in other words, refined. Take what you need. Eat what your body needs, not what your eyes see. Tread softly. For these are the tunes of environmentalists. These are the urgings of the people who care about the community and the planet. So how do I feel about consumption in my home? Do I experience pleasure? Do I feel safe? Do I feel secure? Do I feel connected? Or with this large home movement serving, do I experience indigestion? Does my credit card regret it? What are my bowel movements like? Oof. An attitude that favours minimalist basics. I've got to say this large home movement serving over here really has me worried. I went to Chicago a few years ago, my first time in America. I went to the ice hockey, the Chicago Blackhawks, 50,000 people. I sat next to a 6'4", morbidly obese man in a check shirt. Now, I'm not fat shaming, because this man wasn't exceptional, save for the fact that he was occupying half my seat. He wasn't an outlier, he was in the bell curve. Now, this man, George, started gnawing on some snacks as the game started. Now, he may or may not have been listening to his body, but my momentary half-time relief when he moved was interrupted in a rather disturbing way when he returned with an 18-inch dog hanging out of a bun, covered in a squeezy cheese found in a bottle and dripping in other coloured sauce things. Now, this man, George, his manual handling skills were impressive because he manoeuvred a serious supersize me Coke that looked like one of those big containers of Staminade that sporting teams throw in their coach when they've won a finals victory, all the while nursing a polywaffle that wouldn't have looked out of place at Cape Canaveral. Now, George managed these extra items along with the 18-inch hot dog with only two hands. It was really remarkable, and obviously the visuals stayed with me. So where was I? Second key point. Sometimes we take more than we need. Sometimes we are encouraged by false prophets and advertisers that we need more than what's necessary or what's good for us. So, the third key point, what happened to choice? I mean, George gets to choose what he consumes, so why not people who want tiny homes? What happened to their autonomy? You know, take the zucchini, for example. I don't even like zucchini. I much less want to eat one. I'm a Lebanese cucumber man. Still green, still 70% water. Still a good idea to have greens. I just want my small crisps personally aligned to my taste buds variety. So please don't infantilise me. Don't force feed me and make me eat zucchini just because you want me to. My large home ideologues over here will say that people experienced at risk of homelessness don't get real choice. They've basically said they don't have power or agency and they certainly don't have choice. Well, that's interesting, but not entirely convincing. Oh, happy hearts in the sector. We're proudly consumer-led. We practice human-centred design. You know, we're values-aligned ethicists, united and committed to listening to what clients tell us because they know more about the service system they interact with than we do. Sound right? That's us. So when a meaningful consultation returns specifications that line up with small, cheap to run, easy to clean, space for a run-around pet, fresh air and real neighbours, well, I suppose we should what? Listen, act, deliver on that specification or not? Of course, the problem with unconscious bias is it's unconscious. And so if you've been, the Kool-Aid kids say we should ask clients what they want and then do that. Well, if it's an elegant, pleasurable state of mind, a tiny home, then that's exactly what we should do. In other words, it would be antithetical and a breach of values not to do so. In other words, don't make your problem my problem, their problem. As Rob put it, we're overusing the planet's resources. Tiny homes use less energy. They're an efficient use of capital. What's not to like about them? It was only a few centuries ago as we were living in them. My task here is very, very simple. You know, we've got a situation here where finishing Greta Thunberg. She's busy energising our free radicals to get their kit off in Edinburgh Gardens and to glue themselves to the street in what's appropriately called the Extinction Rebellion. Why? Because this gluttonous large home lobby can't see their way to moderate their consumption or their allure of their McMansions to respect choice or to save the planet. Ignore them, kick them out, bring on the revolution. Now's the time for tiny homes.
Thank you, everybody, for being here at this community debate on homelessness, a notoriously funny topic. My speech today also has an alternative title. I like to call it The End of a Once Promising Career. So my name is Damien, and I'm the policy officer at Council to Homeless Persons. And to be honest, I was a little bit surprised to be invited to be part of this comedy debate today, because a comedy debate is kind of the opposite of what I normally do at CHP. Like, our policy work is really research-driven, and a comedy debate is just, how many dumb things can I say? Well, luckily for all of you, it turns out I can be super dumb without research. The other thing CHP does all the time in its, is a lot of stakeholder engagement, which again, is kind of the opposite of what I think a comedy debate is. Because as far as I can tell, the brief for today is just to say as many mean things as I can to important sector leaders. Hi, Bevan. Please don't make them fire me at the end of this. So Bevan here happens to sit on the CHP board. So in rebuttal to Bevan's points, I'd like to say... That was a really good speech, Bevan. You know, I can be a bit of a nervous public speaker. And frankly, I think that's super unfair. Because look at who we have here on the affirmative team. My, oh my, aren't these some media darlings? Say what you will about tiny houses, and I intend to. But tiny houses have been the most media coverage I've seen on homelessness since the 2017 Australian Open. Of course, the Australian Open led Robert Doyle to try to implement a homelessness ban, and that would have seen a lot of people locked up. So I guess in a way, tiny houses are better, because at least in a tiny house, you get to decorate your cell. But seriously, advocates for tiny houses are always in the media, and it's always with these fantastic new ideas, Like, what if we put all the homeless people in old train carriages? Or what if we put them all in old shipping containers? Or what if we put all the homeless people in abandoned office buildings? And you're like, yeah, that's called a squat. That's not good. You know, tiny houses are often depicted as a solution to homelessness for singles. And so, as a hot single young thing, I thought I might take the opportunity to work through that with you for a moment. So I'm freshly rehoused in a tiny house. For the first time in a long time, things are going good for me. And I've got to tell you, conference, I've just had a haircut. I'm feeling pretty good. Now, I don't know if you noticed this, conference, but I'm actually pretty cute. Thank you. But even if I weren't, like, astonishingly cute, it wouldn't really matter. Because these days there are apps for this sort of thing. You know what I'm talking about, conference? It's time to tiny christen this tiny house. So I line up a date. And unlike everything that I said about the advocates for tiny houses, I'm actually very nice to him. So we decide to go back to mine. We get back to the road reserve that I share with 30 other people. It's very romantic. It's like a tiny fairy village filled with tiny fairy houses. And ladies and gentlemen, there is some fairy magic in the air tonight. We walk up to my white picket fence. That's right, me with a white picket fence. Ladies and gentlemen, did I just become middle class success? I invite him back to my bed. It's just over here, on top of the fridge. We climb the ladder one by one. And we're in my single bed. But if we both lie facing one another, if we try not to move too much, we might just manage to knock boots. Now, I have to ask you guys, does this sound like a good date to you? Because for me, the essential work of homelessness organizations is to put people back in control of the circumstances of their own happiness. And for a lot of people, that happiness includes a loving relationship. For me, this doesn't feel like the circumstances that's going to put me in control of having a loving relationship or having access to one. This feels embarrassing. This feels like how we treat children, or more accurately, how we sometimes treat people who experience homelessness. As the third speaker, it's my turn now to summarize my team's points. Sam pointed out that tiny houses aren't some middle-class Snow White fantasy, that they aren't available long-term, and most importantly, they aren't what we actually want from the government. What we want is social housing. Awkwardly, I do have to distance myself from Sam here just a little bit, because she inferred that the Herald Sun isn't good. The Herald Sun often has cute animal photos on page 2. So let me be very clear. Send your cute animal photos to damien@chp.org.au. Jeanette pointed out that a home isn't really a home if you don't get to make choices around it, if it dictates your lifestyle, and particularly, if it forces you out clubbing all of the time. That home is a bad friend, and it needs to show respect for your need for downtime. She also said that once you account for all of the costs of a tiny house, they're not that cheap. And again, as a single young thing, tell me about it. What even is a conveyancer? Why is it so expensive? Tiny homes are not a solution to homelessness. They're not long-term social housing. They dictate your lifestyle, and most importantly, they make it hard to knock boots. Thank you.
Well, I think we can agree the team certainly brought their A games. We have heard a bit of everything. We've heard some vegetable and brunch analogies. We've heard the very best dating jokes. We've had some facts, we've had some data, we've had cute animals, tiny teddies, Elton John, Greta Thunberg on multiple occasions. We've had some very tough burns, I've got to say, some economic and market rationale and some sustainability points. So it is now your turn as the audience to vote. We're going to go to the poll for those of you who have the app. For those of you who don't, we'll back it up with a round of applause to reinforce the decision. Okay. Time for you to vote on which argument you were most convinced by. Okay. Okay, has everyone placed their votes? We might bring it up on the screen, Belle. Looks like a win for the negative. Can we round it up with a round of applause? Who for the pro tiny homes? And for the negative and the argument, there is such a thing as too small. Okay. I think we've got our answer. Congratulations to the negative team. Thank you to all the debaters who are not only fine and very funny debaters, but also leading members of our sector, and we're lucky to have them as part of it. So congratulations to you all. My particular role to choose the best on ground or the Norm Smith of the prefects, I am going to award it to Damien because I really I almost felt like I was on that date. Okay, I'm now going to hand over to Jenny to wrap it all up for the afternoon. Thanks everyone, and thank you all.
It's really good that Damien has got an award as he goes out looking for his new job. You know. Now, I know you're all walking out the door, but I think you all will trust me if I say I'm going to be really quick to round this out. After two full days of conference, I know the last thing you want to do is to hear all the formalities at the end, but some are required. If I can first thank Lucy for so ably adjudicating the debate, and you know, I thought both arguments were just outstanding, so congratulations to all the debaters. And I think this debate no doubt continues the tradition of us tackling some of the most sensitive issues in our sector, and I think it's a great way to actually get all of the bits of the argument out there in a most civilised and articulate fashion. So here we are at the end of our biennial state conference yet again, and from a national perspective, we've got a Minister for Housing and an Assistant Minister for Homelessness, but no sign of action. Here in Victoria, we've got a government in its second term that has delivered housing and support in the context of tackling family violence, and we hope it will also deliver housing and support following the Royal Commission into mental health. We have a minister who understands what is required and a treasurer who is interested in housing. We already have investments in relation to rough sleeping, and we now have the first tranche of mobile permanent supportive housing support teams. We have a sector that has been innovating for decades, utilising both its own resources and those that have come from government, and imminently we'll have a new state homelessness plan of some sort that will hopefully rise above the stamp duty shortfall and lead to more social housing and contemporary supports. So it is important that we have dragged ourselves away from our only increasing workloads and taken the time to share our expertise and to reflect on our achievements and what we are still to do together. So to start on the thank yous, it really is a significant responsibility to travel across the world to be the centrepiece for a conference for strangers, and Noel Murray was well advised to invite Melanie Redmond and Stephen Gates to visit us, and I do thank David McKenzie for that introduction. It's really been wonderful to have them here, have them share their expertise, and to have the Australian launch of the Canadian edition of Parity. And as I mentioned earlier, poor Noel's got to go off to Calgary for the Canadian launch. And I can't emphasise enough how important sponsorship has been to the success of this conference. So thanks to our major sponsor, DHHS, supporting the conference, the MCM from Ustream, and the Parity conference proceedings to follow. That support is just crucial, just vital. Thanks to Vicky again for the partnership with Melbourne City Mission on behalf of FRUMP and making the youth stream happen that has become such an integral part of this conference. And thanks to our sponsors. I've mentioned DHHS and MCM, big contribution from Launch Housing, Sacred Heart Mission, Homestretch, Vincent Care, Lord Mayor's Charitable Foundation, Uniting, Quantum, Rotary, and Info Exchange. So can you put your hands together for sponsors? Let me just find out where I got up to. Also, thanks to Kim Stevenson and Think Business Events. This is the fourth conference we've done together, and we've done the national conference with them. So, you know, it's a deal, it's a partnership, we do it well together. Thank you all for being here. Thanks for all of the presenters, chairs of conference sessions. I'd like to particularly acknowledge the support of the CHP board, Cathy Humphrey, the chair, and all of the board members, their support for the conference, but for CHP generally. Could you put your hands together for the CHP staff? There's not a one of them that hasn't made a significant contribution to this conference, but I will necessarily pick out a few. Kate Colvin has driven this fabulous conference program, and thanks to our colleagues, Damien Stock, Eleanor Button, Jeff Feidler, Celia Adams, Guy Johnson, Leanne Lewis, Jenny Sams, Wayne Merritt and Pete Zwiers, for their expert advice along the way in developing that program. I think we also should acknowledge Damien Patterson in terms of the work that he did for the Homelessness Awards, and Belinda Lack for the beautiful visual comms that she always delivers. And we'll be very sorry to be losing Belinda shortly. It is a privilege to be the peak body of your sector, and I thank you all for your fabulous support. And it's been so great to see so many active CHP members here. If your organisation doesn't happen to be a member, don't miss out. Go to our website. Join up. And just finally, our AGM is going to be on the Wednesday the 27th of November in the afternoon, and we'll be letting you know what an exciting program that will be very shortly. So see you back here or somewhere like this in 2021. Thank you very much.